taxpayer. Agreement on the old ESP performance, the firm that served out here. Our effort was included, everything from the crossing, credit, farm, our subdivision, and some, anyway, on our side of 3432. And it was under the assumption that, ESP two voluntarily covered us until we could petition for annexation at ESP two. Well, after talking to folks at home, we can't petition ESP two to annex us to the fire, or EMS, because ESP two is EMS and fire. We've already annexed by ESP one. So, since ESP one and the fire station, 3432 and 775, next year there will be an ambulance parked right there at the station. Most of their units, they rolled out ESP one and have paramedics on them. So why would we not want to join ESP three? Not only is that the only option we have, but it's the best option we have. So ESP three, talking to the director and some of their board, they agreed to take us on until we can get a petition probably this summer to be annexed. And would you give them that map?
Okay, there's a map.
See, so that's the map that was used for us to join the ESP one. And as you can see, on the east side and the northwest side of that is one and three. Somehow I slipped on a meeting in December 17th, but this year, when I saw my tax report from the tax assessor, I didn't have any ESP 3 taxes. I thought we were covered. Brother Malone here, Scott Malone and I, went to 110 homes. We got 109 signatures for petition. He told me about that. And the first attempt to bring a petition to the court, but as it turned out, we were advised the court can handle the reassignment at this time and got us to present the petition. So I would say 90% of folks we talked to thought we were under the ESP3 EMS promotion. You know, our commissioner did an approach about it, and he used the right term. We're in a black hole with it. And this realignment would coincide with ESP1. There'll be more confusion on who's supposed to take the call. There's been some overlaps and then some calls not answered. And we think that this is the best thing for our citizens.
I thought they were going to be included in the last vote on the annexation, and we found out that y'all were included.
I don't know whose idea it was to exclude us, but it was just a mistake. And this is going to help us be directed before we you know, we were told we need to annex petition to ESP 2 to be annexed for ESP coverage. We can't split that. We can't split it.
Can you repeat what you said again?
No problem. Would you play that back, Mr. Ripper?
Well, I can point it out that station right there at the intersection, and it's such a quick response. Everybody in the area is
approximately 4 miles closer to the entire area of the service.
What's that going to do with the intersection?
4 minutes not back there from the barber sheets me or something.
Absolutely.
And I know that's coming.
So we would just like to approve that temporary fix until we can annex petition for annexation to ESP 3. And your approval would be dependent upon the presentation to the ESP 2 board and part of the contractuals receiving that in the table between our county attorneys and ESP
2. Mr. Gray, you talked about the whole area of this.
Yes, sir. That's the black hole.
That area is not covered by an EMS.
Right.
And ESD 3?
Yes, that's my question too.
Y'all, David or Eddie Callender is a board member of ESD 3. And y'all are aware of this and you're okay with it?
Yes, sir. Did it get approved by the board already?
It would be
Not officially, because we haven't been asked, but we've talked about it off and on individually. We think it's the better, it's the best thing to do for the residents, and that's what we're all about, is a quicker response, and it's a natural thing to do, because we'll be right there. Otherwise, and there's nothing against District 2, but once we get our unit in that area, they would actually have to drive past us to go to this area so we could already be servicing, be there ahead of time.
That's my understanding, that y'all wouldn't be able to collect taxes on this entity until it was officially annexed.
Correct.
So at this point, y'all are providing coverage for this area at no cost to the residents of the area. Other than services.
How are we going to opt for the to form our own ESD4 EMS?
Probably have got enough coverage area to support
it. And how many names on your?
We have 100.
109?
109. Out of 10 people that we talked about.
And how many people are not covered on that area? On the ESD? It's on the chief.
Precinct 4, how many people you have in Presidential Park, even crossing this, you can see by the presence.
I can tell you that when we have the census, in a couple of years, I have no idea how lot.
About 75% is down there, and 4 is 25%.
So you really have a map of it?
Sorry?
You have a map? Of where they're going to draw the lines?
No, I haven't seen that, but I'm
That's the second
pretty
part.
Sure that, yeah. I'm pretty sure it's
for the ESD1 annexation. Right.
So they won't be taxed until they elect them, should go to that.
We won't be taxed until 2025.
Which was the same situation whenever they came into Laverne ESD, when they moved into Laverne, so they were not taxed
right.
Until it was approved.
Now they're going to have to start a petition and petition ESD3 to join it and time it for it to be about the November election or something like that.
And it'd be a twofold, they'll have to vote to join, and ESD3 will have to vote to accept.
So that's the water hole there. That's
it. Your Honor?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. From the ESD2 perspective, I mean, I understand where that makes a lot of sense. I mean, even though we're starting Cimarron Station, that's, you know, we just started construction on, where even when that one's built, we'd be much closer if we go right through Cimarron and Whispering Oaks to get there. We won't be as close as this one will be. But I guess my question is, will ESD2 continue to provide EMS service in that location until this agreement goes into place? I don't know how long it takes for that to go into place. Not the annexation, but the election, the reassignment. How long it takes y'all, you know, what day would we continue providing service until that day to be sure that the citizens are covered?
David, you guys?
Yeah, I'm just going to make a statement and follow up with the question. So pending to y'all's vote today as far as whatever happens, if it is approved, we can move forward with it. We'll call a special meeting this week here to approve this. Then the next question is, when do you guys, I suppose what Larry's asking, when would you guys want to make this effective?
What was that idea?
When would you want to make this effective?
Oh, assuming it's approved this week, but
therefore,
as soon as you approve it, it makes it effective.
And we have a contract with the owner to provide the service.
Correct. Yes.
Okay, so we would have to get a little bit more contract two or three.
Well, actually, they have agreed to take care of it. Y'all don't get any compensation for it. Remember that?
Well, y'all give us some money as part of that EMS budget money, they'll give us each year to help cover that. And then the only other thing we get, which would be the same thing, they get insurance claims and such, just normal course of business.
intention right now is business as usual. District one provides first responder coverage for us, and they respond out of station one, they're on 87, and they respond out of the station on 3432. And so that will continue. As far as adding ambulances, that plan stays just as it was before. We plan to add the third ambulance at that station on 3432 and 775 in October. Yeah, and so in the meantime, what will happen is they will first respond out of that station on 3432 with the ambulance coming out of the room. And of course, we will evaluate the needs, you know, as we go forward as to if we need to stage an ambulance out there during certain hours or whatnot. But realistically speaking, the call volume in that area isn't high. You know, we're only talking maybe 10 calls a month that come out of that this specific area.
Actually, what this is, it really directs the 911 coverage to this area of UBSD3. Is there anything that y'all are going to have to do?
Well, once they vote on it, then I would think that's fine on that. It gives us to go ahead to get the ACOG and make the changes. So okay. You know how quick they can do it. I mean, it could be a couple of days, it could be a week, I'm not sure.
We have to wait for the ACOG first?
Well, no, not for them to make a decision.
Oh, they make the changes.
They make the changes to the 911 mapping,
And then that's when dispatch will be changing. Could dispatch go ahead and dispatch this area as soon as they approve it, or
that's up to dispatch.
Okay.
As soon as we were made aware of this petition and whatnot, registered Friday last week, in preparation of what may happen today, I went ahead and our plan, depending upon y'all's vote, is we will move forward with calling a meeting on Thursday to get the final approval on this, should that what plays out here. And then with that said, this particular area here is ESN 735, so it's just one ESN that's involved.
Yeah, so it should be pretty quick.
Okay, y'all going to continue to mutualize Rainbow 2 and 2?
We'll continue until we're...
Anyway, the intersection can be moved, and there could be some actions for them apart from what we want to have, but I just want to make sure that all of them are able to agree, it should still be in play, that intersection will be safer.
And as always, we made sure that it's just with mutual aid to provide backup if we have a question.
I passed out a copy of the government code for that. They can check on the
And if that was included under the technology, an expenditure under the technology, I mean, there's like a statute on it, and it is. But the court still has to approve it.
Okay, is this a purchase of a portable, what kind of purchase?
A phone, an iPhone, like this.
For?
One of the JPs.
It's like they're all phone allowance.
It's on the bills.
The county pays.
It's on pay's credit.
All the officials, phone allowances, yes.
But not for the phone.
What she is saying too is that if she used, for instance, as a camera, when the medical examiner wants to see the scene, things of that nature, it's not just talking.
If you, you know, if everybody that gets a phone allowance, the sheriff's office, all the deputies, I'm sure use their phones. I have a phone, I took, you took pictures of that road that we discussed with San Antonio River Authority, and I took a picture of mine. You're opening up a door. Once you do that, everybody here that has an antiquated phone is going to want the county to pay for their phone.
But yes and no, because this money comes out of a special account.
That's what I'm saying.
It's not coming out of the budget.
What everybody do is assess a fee or a fine, a certain percentage of that goes to this fund for the JPs.
Yes.
To be used.
It's a separate JP.
For a fund. Or for electronic.
Yes. That's what people decide.
A phone is not on the list.
I think it's slippery slope myself.
Okay.
Well, only difference is they have, they really only, the department generates money through fees and fines to pay for it. None of our other departments do it, so, but I don't know if we've ever had a policy on how to distribute those funds to the different JPs.
We don't.
So this is Commissioner Hyatt, I'm going to interrupt. Okay, so in that fund, every year between all the JPs, we're bringing about $19,000. What we're spending for is what we got, we have reserves. John Hope had identified that we contain that data through the JP tech fund, which we started doing 2 years ago, which remains our general fund, because that money used to be charged to the JP budget. So that has benefited our general fund. But at some point, if we're bringing in less than what we're spending, because we're paying for the hotspots too on their computers. I mean, right now we've got $29,000, I believe, in the fund. At some point, it's going to win with that, but we're going to have to help subsidize that fund to pay for that data, to pay for the hotspot, to pay for the four JPs.
For years, that fund, it just had the money paid into it, and it wasn't being used.
Yeah, well, they were trying to identify the data, pay the maintenance.
So that's assisting us with that, for that. And it, that does fall under the list that it's okay to use it for.
I mean, we're paying $22,640 this year to budget that data and all the hotspots, although we've got roughly $3,600.
How much revenue is that?
They're bringing about $20,000 a year.
$20,000 a year?
$20,000 a year is what, between all four JPs, because it's all, we see it together under that fund, not my JP. That's my concern. At some point, that's the point where we're going to have to subsidize that funding. You know, paying for the internet, paying for that data.
Well, if the computer statute gives JP discretion on where to spend this at,
no, actually,
we have to approve it.
Yeah, you'll have to approve it, because you're all according to the statute, you make decisions administered by the court. The Justice Support Technology Fund shall be administered by or under the direction of the Commissioner's Court of the County.
In accordance with the law.
Yes.
So we need by the one JP to file off for it?
Well, okay, well, Judge, you just bought your own phone.
Huh?
A long ago, didn't you?
14.
You just bought your own phone. Not long ago.
I mean, I basically, you wanted one of to purchase.
I think. Yeah, we should have had some type of policy that, or the judges should have made it to some type of
when I was in Justice Texas funding, we agreed with the judges that we would present him as a whole to the Commissioner's Court. We would okay it, and then if he wanted to go to the Commissioner's Court. That didn't happen this time. She just decided.
I can buy their own phone? First of all, we don't need this phone every day. We've got office phones. We use it for 1 week out of the month, or it calls, that's about it. So, why do we have to do that anymore? Unless everybody don't get a new phone now.
That's gonna be a little bit of that, though.
That's gonna open a game where everybody should get a phone now.
I just bought my own phone that I use for personal my job. It's what we have our phone allowance each month that I put toward my bill each month.
I'd point out that using personal phones for county business, you expose yourself in the instance that anything illegal happens and they take your phone.
Right.
For whatever reason, your personal information is going to be turned over as well.
So the county does not buy individual phones, has not bought individual phones, and the county gives officials and deputies and a few of the other workers a phone allowance. In my opinion, that should be enough to get by. It's a pretty good allowance. Yes, sir.
I think if we get phone like this, if you lock them, every call you make, you lock them down, that's probably be like 80% personal, 20% business. Because I don't get a lot of calls about, which I do a little bit to the jail here and there, but you don't add up to 80%, 80% of my personal calls.
And I guess what she's saying is not just the phone, right?
It does, but all that information and technology, she's got to go at the office. She's got a computer at the office, and she can access it, do anything she wants to off the bed. You don't have to.
And she can take a photograph and transfer it to them.
Well, you can, but you can do different things for that. When I was a justice speaker, I haven't taken a picture yet.
If you wanted a camera to take photos at the scene, then that's a different story. If the iPhone is not sufficient, but
most any phones that we've got nowadays to take a picture, and we're paying you a fee for. To use your own personal phone.
What, again, we don't have a policy, so to speak, what that money can be used for.
But here it says,
by law, it says there.
For technology for the.
And that's what it is. I mean, I know we're going to keep saying the phone, but iPhone is more used than just talking on the phone. That's the problem I have. It's not really a phone.
We buy the office equipment with
I understand that, Judge.
We buy computers, company machines, not just cell phones. We don't buy cell phones. It's legal to buy one, it is legal. But we don't have to put it on. Nobody's ever done that before. Why start now? I think we all make enough money to buy our phone.
Is this going to be strictly used for the county?
Right.
And there's not going to be any personal calls or anything like that?
Correct.
I mean, it shouldn't.
Correct. That's at least that's what I'm calling.
That's the way I look at it.
Okay, well, are we going to furnish the rest of the justice for these calls?
If we should.
Well, I think you're going to need it. I mean, why furnish it?
Well, the judge is saying that they don't need it, so.
That's what I'm getting at. I talked to three justices of peace, and all of them were not in favor. They were satisfied with their phone allowance.
Three lawyers in our office, and how many others use license?
Okay.
Do I not get license to somebody else
to use it? Okay. Here's the deal with the justices of peace. Like I said, back when I was the justice of peace for the technology fund and on judge production, I'm here because he was part of that also. We agreed for the Justice of Peace to get together before we're going to approach to do something with that fund, to approach the
Jay, do you all agree with that?
Yeah.
No, 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 take it off.
I'll talk to Oliver before we get it.
No, John, I'm saying, you know, the JPs.
He talked to Lee up there, yes.
And I just don't have to come on that, so.
To me, if you're talking an iPad or something that does a better job, where you take a picture and you can see it, and you can transfer that over to your phone, something along that line, maybe so. You know, not only have its own online, but have the capability with a hotspot of going to the computer, you can take the pictures, you can use your hotspot, you can post them. That makes sense. To say that someone's gonna buy a smartphone and not use it for personal use at all, I believe is wrong. But whoever says it, because it's just, there's, that's not.
It's just county property, well, asset tag, you don't have to asset tag anything. I mean, if you don't determine it's county property, but it's worth the asset tag.
Again, I could see something like that. A pad, where you grew up, you can get it, you can enlarge it, you can see the photo, you can go back and transfer it to your computer, you can transfer it to your telephone if you wanted to. But I do not see, and I call it making sense.
Very good customer for the JP's buy a phone. JP3 is wanting to purchase this through this fund that they have. Which difference is we may not have the funds to do that. It's gonna be on our expenditure, so it's out of our budget. Letter purchases will be in the parent's side.
What can we separate all the precincts so everybody has their own? That fund, and everyone has a stock. You got money in your fund, that would want.
Can we do that?
No, we don't. It goes into one fund, it's all combined together, it's not separated by each bank.
Yeah, it all goes to one fund.
How do we go back with the whole money that's been there? Do you have to go back years to determine?
And I think what Judge Muir is getting at is, those two JPs over there put most of the money in the fund out of their reports. They should have a pretty good, here comes